I was glad when they said unto me, let us go into the house of the Lord. God is so good, amen, that David said, I was glad. I got glad when they said unto me. Somebody said, I came running when they said unto me, let us go into the house of the Lord. Amen. Song this morning, the song that we sing this morning out of the hymnal is Joy to the World. Hymnal number 61. Joy to the world, the Lord has come. Let earth receive her King. Let every heart prepare him room. And heaven and nature sing. And heaven and nature sing. And heaven and nature sing. Lift your voices and hearts with me as we sing that together. Joy to the world, the Lord is come. Let earth receive her King. Let every heart prepare him room. And heaven and nature sing. And heaven and nature sing. And heaven and nature sing. Verse 2, joy to the world, the Savior reigns. Let men the sons implore. White fields, floods, rocks, hills, and plains. And repeat the sounding joy, repeat the sounding joy. Repeat the sounding joy. 3, no more let sin sorrows grow, nor thorns infest the ground. He comes to make blessings flow. For as the curse is found, for as the curse is found, for and the curse is found. Verse 4. He rules the world with truth and grace, and made the nations prove the glories of his righteousness. And wonders of his love, and wonders of his love, and wonders of his love. Praise be to God. Amen. Wonders of his love, and wonders of his love, and wonders of his love. Praise God. I know that I am a wonder of his great love. Amen. The reading for today, the liturgical reading, will come from 551 in the back of your hymnal, the traditional, the New Baptist hymnal that we normally use. Amen. Number 551, when you have that, say amen.
Amen.
Amen. If someone is struggling to find it, just reach over and help them. Amen. And it reads, and she fought, and she brought forth her firstborn son, and wrapped him in swaddling clothes, and laid him in a manger, because there was no room for them in the inn. And there were in the same country shepherds keeping watch over their flock. And lo, the angel of the Lord came upon them, and the glory of the Lord shone around about them, and they were sore afraid. Fear not, for behold, I bring you which shall. For unto you is born this day in the city of David a Savior, which is Christ the Lord. Sign unto you, you shall find the babe wrapped in swaddling clothes, lying in a manger. And suddenly there was with the angel a multitude of heavenly hosts, praising God and saying, glory to God, and on earth peace, goodwill toward men. And it came to pass, as the angels were gone away from them unto heaven, the shepherds said one to another, let us now go even unto Bethlehem and see this thing which is come to pass, which the Lord made known to us. And they came with haste, found Mary and Joseph, and the babe lying in the manger. And when they had seen it, they made known abroad the saying which was told to them concerning the child, and all things which were told to them by the shepherds. But Mary kept all these things and pondered them in her heart. And the shepherds returned, glorifying God, as were told unto. Praise be to God. And the shepherds returned, glorifying and praising God for all the things that they had heard and seen, as it was told unto them. Amen. Amen. How many of you got just a little praise in you this morning? I have a little. I'm not talking about that sweet potato pie. Amen. I'm not talking about that lamb chops. And I'm not talking about that, amen, Christmas gift you got. But I have joy in my heart this morning. Amen. Amen. I wish that my bank account, amen, was close to what my joy was. Amen. Don't have to look over your shoulder. Amen. We can live and worship God without somebody picking it outside trying to hurt us. Amen. Because we are free in Christ. Praise be to God. Amen. Next we will have, oh man, an invocation prayer, which is the diaconate prayer. Amen. By one of our deacons will come and give us, amen, an invitational prayer. Invoking the Spirit of God. Amen. Amen. Praise be to God. Now, don't everybody run at one time. Amen. Amen.
This is the day that the Lord hath made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. Yes. Heavenly Father, almighty and all-wise God, we want to say thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you for letting us see another day. A day we never seen before and a day we'll never see again. This is a day that you have truly made, and we should rejoice and be glad in it, because a whole lot of people did not see this day. A whole lot of people woke up this morning and was not the same way that they were the day before. A whole lot of people woke up this morning and did not have the things that they had only yesterday. But this day that you have made, we shall rejoice in it for the things that we have, because nothing is not promised to us tomorrow. Everything we have is in your hand and owned by you. And all we can do is say, thank you, Lord,
praise
for giving
God
us this day.
Yes, God.
Heavenly Father, we ask that you go along the highways and byways of life to bless these people that are going through this world in trouble, in pain, or lost. They need your helping hand. They need your loving touch to guide them, bring them back to the ways that are good.
Yes,
we ask that you bless all our leadership, from the Congress and the President all the way down to the pastor and the minister here in our family. Guide them. Teach them the ways of yours. Guide them to do the right thing so the people can be led to the light. Heavenly Father, we ask you to touch the ones that are doing wrong, because every day that you have made is another opportunity for them to have an opportunity to change their heart. And hopefully they will listen and change into righteousness. We ask you to go to the hospitals and touch the sick and shut-in, the people who are mentally and physically disabled, who need your help on this day. We ask that you continue to bless the ones here at the St. Louis Baptist Church, the pastor and his wife on the road, the pastor here that's going to give us the word, and all of the congregation that are blessed to see this day that you have made. And finally, Heavenly Father, we want to thank you especially for your son Jesus, because Christmas is called Christmas. It means that your son Jesus was born and gave us an opportunity to become under the auspices of grace and freed from the auspices of law. Before Jesus came, we were under the auspices of law, sacrificing animal blood to wash away our sins. But you sent your only begotten Son that whosoever believeth in you should not perish, but have everlasting life. And because Jesus shed his blood for us, our lowly sinners here on earth, all we have to do in order for you to hear our prayer,
yes,
is to all say, in the name of Jesus. And you, Heavenly Father, will always hear our prayer.
Yes.
And because of Jesus' sacrifice,
yes,
his birth, his death, his resurrection,
yes,
all of those things, because those happen, we are now under the auspices of grace. And that's what we're thankful for most of all in this last Sunday in 2021. Thank you, Heavenly Father, for your son Jesus sacrificing for our sins.
Yes.
This prayer I say in the name of Jesus, all blessings flow. Amen,
amen,
and amen.
Calling you and asking you to pray for them. But man, you can tell them we're going to pray for you right now. Amen. Amen. Let us pray. All wise and eternal God, the one who loves across generations, the God of the ancient day, the God who loves despite religion, despite culture, language, despite color of skin, height, amen, or weight, the one who continues to love even when we don't love God back. Lord, we come before your presence grateful and thankful for all you've done for us. God, we don't even know all that is encapsulated in the salvation and glory that you shine through us, God. But the little bit we do know, we say thank you. But God, we pray for our uncles and aunties, our nieces and nephews, our children. God, we pray for them right now, God, that you, amen, would show them that light, allowing us to be vessels of that light, helping them to see their way. God, we have children, amen, and nieces and nephews and cousins, God, who are wondering. Some are wondering for a husband or wife. Some are wondering for a better job. Some are wondering and have all those things, but yet wonder without peace. Help us to show them that light this morning. God, someone is in a hospital, totally dependent on the doctors. God, we're praying that you would show up as a nurse's assistant, show up as a doctor or an assistant, even a janitor, if you will, God, a therapist. Show up, showing them that they depend on you to guide their hands and guide their thoughts, God. We pray for them, God. Someone today is out there in our family and friends who has taken alcohol during their break and relied on that to give them the rest and the calmness and peace that they need. Help us, oh God, through our lifestyle, through the ways that we live in joy and peace, to show them that light, if you will, God. Help them to put the drugs down. Help them to put the alcohol down. God, someone wants to throw in the towel today. Some have thrown in the towel on their marriage, thrown in the towel on their job, thrown in the towel even on their life, God. Allow us to be vessels of intervention, showing them that there is a better way. There is another way. God, we ask, God, that you move through us, move through our children, move through our neighbors who have that light, to show them a better way. We pray for our country today that is divided in culture, divided in religion, God. Help us to find places of unity in Congress, unity in the House of Representatives, unity in the mayor's office, and unity in the city halls. God, help us to find places of unity. God, you came that we might have life, and in that life it would be more abundantly. And so we pray, knowing that weeping may endure for a night. But oh, blessed be to God, we know that joy will come in the morning. God, we pray right now, not a prayer that's dismal, not a prayer of abyss, not even a prayer of tradition. But God, we pray a prayer of faith. For by faith, God, we know that you are, and you are a rewarder to them that diligently seek you. This is our prayer today, in Jesus' name. Amen. And thank God. Amen. How many of you are walking by faith this morning? Anybody walking by faith? Amen. I'm walking by faith. Now, I didn't say a faith check. Amen. I didn't say a faith scan on the credit card. Amen. I'm walking by faith. Amen. When I go out the door. Amen. And when I come back in. Amen. I'm walking by faith when I go out to the job. Amen. I walk by faith when we get to church. Amen. So we're walking by faith. And so we pray a prayer by what? By faith. Amen. I believe my prayer. I don't know about you, but I believe that when I pray, God changes things. Praise be to God. I'm Reverend Troy Denson, if you don't know. Amen. I have been invited to preach in the stead. Amen. I can't dare say the shoes, but in the stead. Amen. Of the pastor, Aubrey Lewis Sr. He so gracefully asked me to fill in today while he takes Sabbath, amen, in Georgia with his children. And so we thank God for him. We pray a safe return, and we thank God for you holding things together. Thank you so much, Brother Sister Bethea. Thank you so much, Sister Stevens, and those who were there. Open the door, amen, faithfully. That's my report. God bless all of you. And to all of you who are viewing us, amen, on CNN, on the broadcasting network, and on Facebook Live, God bless you for tuning in. Amen. We're thinking about you. Praise be to God. Now, I'll sit down, and we'll get a selection from the piano player. Amen. What do you have for us? Play something that we can all do. Amen. Can enjoy and worship God. place. All kinds of diseases. People are wasting away. Economy's down. Can't get enough pay. But as for me, all I can say is thank you, Lord, for all you've done for me. Praise be to God. And it could have been me outdoors with no food, no clothes. Just another number with a tragic end without a friend. Amen. But it didn't seem fit to let any of these things be. Every day by his power, he keeps on blessing me. Thank you, Lord, for all you've done for me. That's what he was playing. Thank you so much, son. Amen. God bless you. God bless you is our prayer. Amen.
Let's go on and do Black History. And I just wanted to do something that you are familiar with. The National Anthem. Everybody's familiar with the National Anthem?
Yes.
Now, the backstory of the National Anthem seems to be one of the best kept secrets in American history. We see white people getting angry all over the country because black people are now realizing that the National Anthem wasn't made for them. And then, remember back in starting in 2016 with Kaepernick doing the kneeling? The National Anthem is played in sports events and other venues. We see and hear sports and news pundits decry how athletes are disrespecting the flag and other people are disrespecting the flag and dishonoring fallen American troops. And that we are ungrateful for the opportunities provided by them in this country. All because we're not showing respect for the National Anthem. Now, the history of the National Anthem is a fine example of how institutional racism clouds the minds of people who do not understand or possibly do not want to understand the reasons why most black people do not totally respect this song. Let's start with the author of the National Anthem, the lyrics, Francis Scott Key. Now, the music itself was written by a British composer and an early musicologist named John Stafford. He was from Britain, and he wrote the music that you know from the National Anthem in 1773. But it remained lyricless until 1814, when American lawyer and amateur poet Francis Scott Key put his poem entitled Defense of Fort McHenry to that music. He was inspired to write it after he saw the American flag flying above Fort McHenry and after the U.S. forces fought off an attack by the British forces during the Battle of Baltimore. However, the anthem wasn't adopted until March 3, 1931. In the 19th century, Hail Columbia was used at official functions, the same song that we know as My Country, 'Tis of Thee, whose tune was the same as the United Kingdom national anthem, God Save the Queen. Following the War of 1812 and other U.S. wars, few other songs were used to suggest for the country's main anthem, including America the Beautiful. But more recently, there have been crowds to discard the national anthem all completely because the author, who was Francis Scott Key, was a slave owner. Now, Francis Scott Key, the writer of the lyrics of the Star-Spangled Banner / National Anthem, was not only a slave owner and a lawyer, he owned 14 slaves, he wrote in his writings that blacks are, quote, a distinct and inferior race of people, which all experience proves to be the greatest evil that afflicts a community. Unquote. That's what he wrote in his writings about black people. And it goes on to say that King did not have enslaved black people in America in mind when he penned the words, the land of the free and the home of the brave. So in other words, any black American who wants to do so has every right not to stand up for the national anthem, in my opinion. The song never represented people of color, especially black Americans, in this country anyway. And the lyrics specifically, I will just quote before I finish off. It's the third line that nobody ever sings in the national anthem. They always sing the first two lines. They never sing the last line. Quote, their blood has washed out their foul footsteps' pollution. No refuge can save the hireling and slave from the terror of flight or the gloom of the grave, and the star-spangled banner in triumph doeth wave o'er the land of the free and the home of the brave. In other words, no way that any black people were going to be represented in America as the land, in the land of the free and the home of the brave. Amen.
Amen.
In terms of a pastoral emphasis, I want to thank all of you who prayed for a story, my son, and many of the other children who performed in last week's program. Thank you so much, Brother Bethea, Sister Bethea, and your pastor, amen, Aubrey Sr. and his wife, they were there, amen, and we knew that your prayers were there, because my son has an unusual rhythm that he was able to step and step and stride, and stride. You know, he don't normally sing, but he sung a solo silent night, had us thinking that he was a part of the Temptations, amen. So we just thank God for you and your support, amen, and shout out to Reverend Davis, Charles Davis of Full Gospel Baptist Church. He came, and we thank God for Reverend Roberts, amen, pastor over at 19th Street. Him and his children came. So many saints came and supported us. We just thank you for that from the bottom of my heart. You know, my mom used to say, you can't pay nobody to be grateful and nice to you, amen? It has to come from within. So we just give thanks to you for that. Once again, my name is Reverend Troy Denson, amen. Pastor is in Georgia, as you know, visiting his children, Sabbath for him. And so we thank God for him for this opportunity to give a word of the Lord for him. We give unto thee together. All things come of thee, O Lord, and of thine own have we given thee. Amen. Amen. God bless you. God blesses a cheerful giver. Praise be to God. Amen. Next we will have a selection, moment of meditation, played for us by our resident musician, Master Story Denson. And after that, we will hear a word from the Lord. Amen? God bless you. Something that they know. everybody. Man, I kind of sprayed up here, so I'm going to remove my mask so that you can hear me. Thank you so much, Master Story. He's still learning. Amen. I'm sure you all knew the song, O Night Divine. Amen. Continue to pray for him as he gets it together. Yesterday we got him a, we had already purchased him an organ, the organ feet pedals. So when every year he has something to dance off of. And so this year when he opened that package and saw those pedals, he went running around the house. Amen. So we just try to empower his gift, even as you empower your, amen, your grandchildren, empower your nieces and nephews, and even your children. Amen. Some of us want to be empowered with money. Amen. Amen. And so we give them money to empower them. Thank you so much again. Amen. This is all about the Lord. Amen. And so we thank God for all that God is doing. Praise be to God. Word of the Lord, amen, comes from this morning. St. Matthew chapter 2, verses 9 through 12, with emphasis on verse 12. Amen. St. Matthew chapter 2, verses 9 through 12. Praise be to God. And it reads, when they had heard the king, they departed, and lo, the star which they saw in the east went before them till it came and stood over where the young child was. When they saw the star, they rejoiced with exceeding great joy. And when they were coming to the house, they saw the young child with Mary his mother, and fell down and worshipped him. And when they had opened their treasures, they presented unto him gifts, gold and frankincense and myrrh. And being warned of God in a dream that they should not return to Herod, they departed in their own country another way. Can someone say another way?
Another way.
Amen. Pray with me. Oh, wise and eternal God, we just bless you and thank you for this moment. Lord, it was a word that changed our heart. In a song, in a casual conversation with one of your followers, or even there at the church, we heard a word and it changed the trajectory of our lives. We pray, oh God, that you would touch those that are under the sound of your servant's voice and change the trajectory of their lives. Now, Lord, lay some soul upon my heart and bless that soul through me. And I will do my reading and speaking part to deliver that soul through thee to the matchless name of Jesus our Lord. Amen. And thank God.
Amen.
The title of the message that I'd like to offer to you this morning, what can we do in the season after Christmas? What can we do in a season after Christmas? Some of us are wondering how we will pay our bills, the credit cards, and how we will recover after we spend all of that money on gifts to warm people's hearts. I know that's not you here, that's that other church. Amen. Some of us are confused as to what the new year will hold for us. Some of us are wondering what we will do with our lives since Christmas. We did all that planning. The dinner has happened. The gifts have been opened. The grandchildren have gone home. The family and friends, the party season is over. Well, for some of us it is. Amen. And we're wondering what we will do. In Congress, they're wondering what they will do with the Build Back Better plan. How they can get one person to change his mind to help the poor people in the poorest state in the nation, West Virginia. What will we do after Christmas? What will we do when Congress convenes? What will I do with my personal life after Christmas? I sure don't want somebody saying, I don't want my Christmas next year to be like this one. So someone is trying to get a job. Someone's trying to get a better job. What are we going to do after Christmas? Someone has changed their lifestyle. They've moved with their children, and some senior saint is saying, I wonder what I'll do with myself since I retired. Someone has moved from where they live to another part of the country, and they're wondering what they can do with themselves. Someone has gotten a great investment, a lot of money, and they were poor all of a sudden, and now they got a lot of money. Like, what will I do with myself? Amen. What will we do with ourselves? We often wonder what we'll do with ourselves. Someone graduated, they're wondering what major they will take. We make these questions all the time. But I'd like to focus it right now after Christmas. Normally when I send out letters and cards, I still mail out cards. Even though we have the internet, I still mail them out. And I don't write Christmas. I write Christmas. Christ, C-H-R-I-S-T, dash mass. Because this is the time that Emmanuel was with us. That's when we celebrate. Not necessarily that date, but that's a date we decided to celebrate. Christ being with the masses. God with the masses. What will we do after Christmas? Well, in this text, often this is an epiphany of Christ. In the upcoming January season around the world, the epiphany is celebrated. And we're not January yet, so this is a prophetic message. The epiphany is the reflection of meaning of something that previously, what just happened? Something that just happened that changed my life, so now what will I do with it? You know, being a Christian at 16 years old is quite different than being a Christian at 70-something years old. Being a Christian as a single person is quite different than being a Christian as a married person. We have different themes of our life that our Christian or God-like walks look different. So now we say, what will I do after Christ has come into my life? What will we do? The Spirit of God allowed me to focus on Matthew chapter 2, verse 9 through 12, in which the wise men rejoiced, bowed, and worshiped the newborn baby named Jesus, said to be our Christ. And their worship consisted of presenting gifts of gold, frankincense, and myrrh. As an epiphany of what had been prophesied was occurring in their very eyes. And what this occurrence meant to their mission had all been born right in front of them. Well, what will we do since the Savior, the King, has come, watch this, as a baby in swaddling clothes in a den where the cattle were raised? What can we do with that? What in the world? In verse 11, the giving that they gave provided meaning. The King had been born. The giving of myrrh, gold, frankincense, and myrrh all had meaning, mission, and a message. In verse 11, it provided a meaning. The King had been born. The giving of frankincense provided a message. The message that God can be trusted. God is faithful. The giving of myrrh provided a mission. Jesus' death. It was an embalming fluid for a king. Jesus' death was supposed to be our outcome, death. But in this miraculous death, Jesus reformed death to resurrection, which simultaneously meant our mission is now to resurrect or reform all of Christendom and humanity. The Bible says, I came that you might have life, and in that life you have it more abundantly. The Bible says, ask and it shall be, you shall receive. Seek and ye shall find. What? Knock and the door shall be opened to you. The Bible says, just as God takes care of the flowers in the field, the fowl in the air, so much more we to give unto his children. What will we do after Christmas? I will offer words from this text, from these wise men, that God led to them. Amen. That we should have an abundant life. Praise God. Amen. Somebody ought to thank God right there. You ought to say thank God. Amen. As a result of this moment of prophetic worship, this epiphany has become a public holiday. Reverend R. Berry Jr., amen. It's a public holiday in countries like Austria, countries like Colombia, South America, Croatia, Cyprus, Poland, Ethiopia, parts of Germany, Greece, Italy, Slovakia, Spain, and Uruguay. The time after Christ is considered an epiphany, and they celebrate it just as much as they do Christmas as a national holiday. But according to timeanddate.com, the only places, here we go, that's why I emphasize our historian in the house of Black history, the only place at this moment where the epiphany of prophetic worship is not a public holiday is Australia, Canada, the United Kingdom and the first world nations who are rich in power and war, they don't celebrate what Christ meant. After I allude that we may not have a good meaning, a good understanding of the meaning of Christ. Amen? So the response to what shall we do after Christmas is found in our scripture today. The etymology or meaning of epiphany proposes two words. We ought go forth. Go forth. This text tells us that the wise men did not return back from whence they came. They were inspired to go forth. Thus, in this text, the wise men were to go forth in meaning, go forth in message, and go forth in mission. In other words, their words and their experience ought to line up with their action, their mission. You say, I love God. You sing, I love God. Then let's go back in mission like we love God. Let the church say amen. Amen. Yeah. But prior to the wise men experience of Christ to go and share witness of Jesus immediate days of birth and go forth, they were called to what we would call a conference call. The pretext says when Herod the king heard this, he was troubled and all Jerusalem with him. And when he had gathered all the chief priests and scribes of the people together, he inquired of them where Christ would be born. They went to a conference call by this world leader. And at the conference, the evil one, Herod, had conspired no good intentions. He said to the wise men, go and search carefully for the young child. And when you have found him, bring him back to bring back word to me that I can come and worship him. Some people, I dare to say, come to fellowship without good intentions. Some people, I dare to say, even give offerings without good intentions. I dare to say, some people, every other word is praise God or blessings. We have the Christian language, but not necessarily with good intentions. Then following the focal scripture, whereas they beheld the baby Jesus and his mother Mary, the text says, then being divinely warned in a dream that they should not return to Herod, they departed for their own country another way. They went another way. In other words, these wise men's Christ's experience had conflicted with the conference call, conflicted with their culture, conflicted with their worship. And I dare to say it conflicted with their religion. So they opted to go another way to their country and home. The cheat sheet of my message today regarding the day after Christ is that prophetic worship is spiritual conflict management. If we're going to be prophetic, we're going to do some conflict management. Amen. And when Martin Luther King said, I have a dream. That our children will be judged by the color of their skin, but by the content of the character that created, oh bless him, conflict management right there. Hold on, I'm getting happy. Saints used to sing a song that says, I'm on my way to Canaan land. I'm on my way to Canaan land. I'm on my way to Canaan land. Praise God, praise God, to Canaan land. You know what they went on to say, brother, that if you don't go, I'll carry on. If you don't go, I'll carry on. If you don't go, I'll carry on. I'm on my way, praise God, to Canaan land. I know young folks don't know that song. They don't know. Are you on your way? Amen. To the promised land. Abraham went on his way. Not seeking a land that was made by the hands of man, but whose builder and maker was God. Are you on your way? Amen. I don't know about you, but I'm on my way. Now, if you don't go, I got enough confidence in the Lord that I'll carry on. Amen. Well, hold on now. Let me give some content. Amen. When I thought about this text, fellow brothers and sisters, in our present day where believers of Christ are pulled in so many ways that can lead to confusion, even between God followers. You ever gotten a religious conversation with folks who are supposed to be Christians? It causes cultural conflict. You see it. Our evangelists, evangelical churches in the art with the Protestant, so-called Protestant church, and even the black church. What do you know? And all of that lead to ungodly suffering. We worship on Sunday, we give all this money on Sunday, build beautiful sanctuary, but we can't even get along. We don't have corresponding actions. And what can we as believers do? That's the rhetorical question. In this season after Christ's Mass, In this post-Christ birth experience, the wise men, this is what they did. They visited Jesus. Scripture depicts that they, when they saw Jesus, they fell down, God bless his name, and worshiped. You say, well, what does worship have to do with finance? What does worship have to do with the economy? What does worship have to do with illegal aliens? And what does worship have to do with Eric Dyson, an ordained Baptist minister and professor of sociology at Georgetown University? He said, Jeremiah Wright, you know about Jeremiah Wright, is one of the greatest prophetic preachers that Black America has produced. He quoted Wright saying, "What I find striking is that many white brothers and white sisters of Christ miss the fact that there would not be a Black church if the white church wasn't political and racist in refusing to worship with us." I wish I had some help right there. What Eric Dyson and Jeremiah Wright are saying is that if prophetic worship truthfully tells the truth about the past, if there wasn't any racism, if there wasn't any politicism, if there wasn't any cultural division, we'd be all in this church. We'd have to open up another floor to St. Luke Baptist Church. That wouldn't be a Black church. Prophetic worship looks at the past clearly and truthfully. Let the church say amen. A prophetic worship of God, observe the past, is a historic present worship. Many of you who come to Reverend Lewis's Bible study, you know that Moses prophetically talked about the beginning. Moses wasn't even there in the beginning, but God, oh bless his day, spoke to him, and he was able to prophesy and write Genesis. I wish I had some help. When we experience Christ, we can look back on our lives and see the calamity, and we can say, oh, I thank God for that valley, because I know God can bring me out. I thank God for the confusion. I thank God that I was broken, busted one day, couldn't be trusted, but thanks be to God, he brought me out. God give you a view of the past in order to give you a bright future. The church ought to say amen right there. The prophet Isaiah in chapter 9, verse 6 to 7, 6 through 7, prophesied about Jesus the King. He prophesied from the past about the future. Here's what he said. He said, "For unto us, oh bless him, a child is born. To us a son is given, and the government will be on his shoulder, and he will be called Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. Of the greatness of the government and peace, there will be no end. He will reign on David's house." He looked backwards. "David's throne and over his kingdom, establishing and upholding it with justice," oh bless him, "and righteousness. From that time and forevermore, the zeal of the Lord will accomplish it." He looked back over, oh bless his name, David, who was long before Isaiah. He looked back over it and he said that Jesus, the Messiah, is coming. Didn't he come? Didn't he come to Mary? Didn't the angel of the Lord light up on this woman? What God did in the past, he will do, oh bless his name, right now. And sure enough, Jesus, the King of Kings, was born of a virgin birth, and fittingly, the wise men brought him gold, according to prophetic. What are you bringing to God in your reading of the word? What are we bringing to God in our ushering? What are we bringing to God in our deaconing and trusting? What are we bringing to God in our preaching and in our playing of musical instruments? Are we playing for the King? I wish, I don't know about you, but I try to. These wise men worship by bowing down and giving gold means that they could trust God, that he was a king. Does anybody, can't you trust God by now? Haven't we walked with God long enough to be able to trust God? I can trust God with my money. I can trust God with my spouse. I can trust God with my job. You can trust God with your pension. And God will not let you down. Let the church say amen. My friends, in this holiday season of 2021 and 22, we can worship Jesus the King that has come by offering a, not just any kind of worship, a prophetic worship of Christ, meaning we too, oh bless him, can trust God, the King, that he has come. My friends, each year of Christmas, we can praise God for an opportunity of historic worship. Amen. We can worship God, oh bless his name, for historic present worship. We can worship the God of the past. We can worship the God of the ancient day right now. Saints used to sing a song saying, give me that old time religion. Give me that old time religion. Give me that old time religion. It's good enough for me. Is the Lord good enough for you? Thus, when we faithfully observe the past, we can begin to trust God together. Author Sam Shepard, whose name is Samuel Shepard Rogers III, a Christian former American actor, playwright, author, screenwriter, and director whose career spanned half a century, he once said this. He said, In real life, we don't know what's going to happen next. So how can you be that way on a stage? Because he was an actor, screenwriter. Be alive to the possibility of not knowing exactly how everything is going to happen the next. If you can find places to have that happen on stage, it can resonate with an experience of living. Oh, blessed be to God. You don't know what's going to happen next. But if you can feel God, oh, in your presence, if you can feel God on your way to work, if you can feel the presence of God in your shower or in your bed or on your meal table, then God is likely to move on that job. God is likely to move in our, oh bless his name, in Congress. And if we can feel God right now, then God is omnipresent, not just here, but he's in Congress. He's in the main, oh bless his name. He's on the job, oh bless his name. When you send your children off to college, God is with them. Touch yourself and say, I can trust God. Go ahead and pat yourself and say, I can trust God. A prophetic worshiper observing God in the present is also a future. In other words, if I can worship God in the present, God will guide my future. Oh, we can worship God about the past, the King come. But I'm telling you, if we can worship and feel God's presence, oh, bless his name. Oh, we can trust God with our future. Oh, blessed be to God. A prophetic worship. Now, a prophetic worship, hold on a second there. A prophetic worship is not necessarily waving your hands and shouting. No, a prophetic worship is doing something different. Oh, I wish I had some help. I started a company called National Collaborative Institute of Leadership. I have a whopping, busting out the scene, total of 5 students. Amen. I wish somebody would get that. Because God is not speaking about right now, but God is speaking about the future. I don't know about tomorrow. Tomorrow is up ahead, but I know the one who holds my future. Life is just because of living, because he lives. I put all 3 of those songs together to let you know, oh, bless his name, because you can feel him right now. That's the same God of the past, and God is even in the future. In our text, hold on there, in St. Luke chapter 2, verses 25 to 32, later on in Jesus' life, he said, at this time, a man named Simeon, he was living in Jerusalem. Simeon was a good man. We're talking about what to do after Christ, man, after Christmas. Simeon was a good man. He loved God and was waiting for God to save the Israelites. God's Spirit came to him and told him that he would not die until he had seen Christ the Lord. And when Mary and Joseph brought Jesus to the temple to do what the law of Moses said should be done for a new baby, the Spirit, oh bless his name, Simeon, told Simeon to go into the temple. And Simeon took the baby, Jesus, in his arms, and guess what he did? He praised God. That's what he said. He said, Lord, oh, bless him. I can die in peace now because you have kept, hold on there, your promise to me. With my own eyes, I've seen what you have done to save your people, and foreign nations will also see this. Your mighty power is a light for all nations, and it will bring honor to your people. In other words, the good man, Simeon, prophesied that the prison Jesus that he was holding as a baby, a little boy, the fulfillment of God's promise is the Messiah and will be the Savior for the Israelites and the Gentiles. I wish you would get that. In other words, this was a little boy, but he saw him riding on King Jesus. Has God ever spoken to your heart and told you that that trouble will pass? Has God ever spoke to your heart and told you to take that job even though it's not paying much and you ended up retiring there and buying a house? Has God ever spoken to your spirit something very odd, something very uncanny, but it turned out to be your blessing? And then in St. Luke chapter 2, verse 36 through 38, and that was Anna, the prophet, the daughter of Phanuel of the tribe of Asher. She was of great age and had lived with a husband 7 years from her virginity. And she was a widow of about 84 years, which departed not from the temple, but served God with fasting and praying. And she coming in that instant gave thanks likewise to the Lord and spoke of him to all of them that looked for redemption in Jerusalem. In other words, oh, bless his name, Anna prophesied that their present moment, oh, bless him, in the first century A.D., that Jesus is and will be the high priest. And so the frankincense that the wise men gave represented the present future worship of God as high priest. Frankincense, the dried up sap of trees in the Boswellia genius, particularly in Boswellia sacra. These trees grow in Amman, Yemen, and Horn of Africa, including Somalia and Ethiopia. And so the wise men's gift of frankincense is the futuristic present, oh bless his name. They're blessing God, oh bless him, with your future. Don't worry about your pension. Don't worry about your body. Don't worry about what God will do with those grandchildren. Don't even worry about what God, you just keep praying and believing. Saints used to sing a song, say, trust and obey, for there's no other way to be happy with Jesus. Is to do what? Is to trust and obey. Oh, bless his name. Oh, bless him. I'm running on to a close. In addition to Jesus being emblematic, trusting of God in the ancient day, Jesus is the way, Jesus is the truth, and Jesus is the light for we believers and followers of God in our future. Let the church say amen. Amen. Through this initial thought of Sam Shepard, preponderances of thoughts envisioning our spirit, we can lay a foundation for our future. Praise God. Last but not least, Diane Butler. I'm giving you commentary of what they thought about this text. A famous American historian of Christianity and an advocate for progressive Christianity and an independent scholar who writes on American religion and culture. She's even from Baltimore, Maryland. She's wrote 11 books. This is what she said. She said, in many quarters, religion abandoned a prophetic and creative vision of humanity's common life in favor of an individual quest to get one sorry ASS to heaven. Oh, God. And in the process, community became isolated behind the walls of buildings where worship experiences corresponded to the members and forgot about the community. We're so concerned about getting to heaven that we don't worry about our neighbors. We're so worried as to whether there's dust on the organ. We're so worried as to whether the carpet is clean. We're so worried as to how my sister and brother shouted. We're so worried as to how much money is in the offering basket that we're not worried about the attacking our voting rights. We don't worry about how they're strategizing the geographic region to sniff out your votes. We're not worried about the fact that they allow the Hispanic immigrant refugees to come in, but they sent the Haitians back to Haiti. We're so heavenly bounded that sometimes we're no earthly good. But Jesus, oh bless his name, Jesus, somebody say Jesus. He connects heaven with earth. I wish somebody get there. We believe in earth, and we believe in heaven, but I just thought I'd plug in Jesus right there in the middle. My presence of the Holy Spirit. Oh, bless him. He's a way maker. Oh, bless his name. He's a heavy load carrier. He is a wheel in the middle of a wheel. Can somebody say Jesus? Worship, observing the fate of outcome of humanity and God, can be appreciated through the wise men's gift. They did something about it. The Savior was to be born. The researchers looked at it through history. Some of us read this stuff and we say, oh, that's pretty nice. But these wise men, the magi, they did something about it. They came to Jesus, they bowed down and worshiped. They didn't just say, thank you, Jesus, praise God, and speak in some language. But they brought gold to say that a king is here. Y'all remember Muhammad Ali? Muhammad Ali, when he came into the ring, before he even laid his gloves out, he would come down there saying, the king is here. The king is here. The king is here. When we shout that the king is here, it puts fear in the hearts of the enemy. Oh, blessed be to God. Through Christ, the king is here. They did something about it. They prophesied his death. They prophesied that he would rise. This bittersweet gift. Hold on there. Even without the mummification process, myrrh was connected to the faith and death and the burial, a disheartening gift for a new mother to hold, yet beautiful in light of her understanding of his purpose. His brothers and sisters through myrrh prefigured of Christ's death and embalming. It's worth mentioning that frankincense and myrrh are mixed together, both used in temple rituals, a medicinal combination. In other words, while Jesus was the mobile temple as the high priest, filled with aromatic substance through myrrh or death, he was also fighting disease. He was also protecting the body. In other words, it was saying that Jesus would protect us. Jesus would be a voice for us. And I hear the gospel message in this as I run on to my clothes in this divine combination of frankincense and myrrh. While Jesus was being betrayed on the cross later on, the divine combination defined his mission of affirmation between God and humanity. While Jesus was being marched from kangaroo court to kangaroo court, divine combination defined his mission of bridging the gap between human cultures and even God's spiritual culture. While Jesus was forgiving those crucifying him later on in his life, the divine combination defined his mission of providing forgiveness for all of humanity today. And later on in his life, when Jesus cried out, Tetelestai, it is finished. Father, I commend my spirit to thee. And when they put him in a borrowed tomb, he laid there all night the first night of his death. He laid there all night the second night of his death. But early on the third day of his death, he rose with all power in his hands. For resurrecting our human condition, dead had become life. Jesus, oh bless him, reformed death and put life in it. He took the period off of death and put a comma in it. He put, oh bless his name, a sickness. He turned it into healing. He reformed sight. He took blindness and made sight out of it. I wish I had some help today. And for resurrecting our spiritual body from eternal life on that great and eschatological spiritual day to eternal life with our Heavenly Father. Oh, bless his name. And in our human life in this 21st century, this day after worship, this day after Christmas, his historic present prophetic day of worship, this future present prophetic worship, all means that we believers of God, the body of Christ, we have the way, we have the truth, and we have the light within us, with a mission of rising from racism to recognizing the human race, rising from unconscious biases to dignity for all people, rising from unlivable wages to equitable shared resource manager and the worker, rising from unlawful death, rising from unlawful acquittals to justice for all, and living on our earthly and human destiny on the new earth and new heaven. The text said that they bowed and worshiped with gold. They bowed and worshiped with frankincense. They bowed and worshiped with myrrh. And this verse meaning that God, oh bless his name, can be trusted. That God, that Jesus is Lord of all. And the mission, oh bless his name, for us to reform our law, to reform our justice. We have a mission in that. Hold on a second. In this, the Savior came, that's on God. In this, the King came, that's on God. But watch this, when he mingled it all together and they went another way, that's on us. As I give this a close, What can I do as a result of this happening with Christ? What we do after Christmas? I want the ladies in your spirit, being warned of God in a dream that they should not return to Herod, they received, number one, a divine message. Don't go back the way you came. They received, that's, you know, therefore, you know, point number one, they received the divine message. Secondly, they departed to their own country. They received divine direction. I wish y'all get that. A divine message, divine direction, And the text says, they departed another way. Jesus said, I'm the way, the truth, and the life. So today, when we offer God a prophetic worship, we receive a divine message, divine direction, and a divine destiny to serve our community together. So that's the importance of hearing a word of God for today, the 21st century. Not incriminating our white brothers, not incriminating our Latino brothers and sisters, not incriminating our LGBT community, not incriminating other people, but giving a message of God that will change our lives so that we can live in harmony together. Living in harmony doesn't mean that I'm not going to challenge us about our ungodly lifestyle. See, with my son, I'm done. Y'all can relax now. I love my son. But every now and then, I have to chasten my son. Simply because I give a word that challenges the church to love the LGBT community, to love the Latino, love the Haitian, love even our Caucasian brothers and sisters. Simply because I give a word, it means that it should reform the church before it reforms outside. I wish I had some help. We're accustomed to getting at the pulpit and incriminating. That's what people are afraid of. They're afraid that African Americans will come into power and do revenge on them. I wish I had some help. But instead, God is calling us to love them that do evil against us. Oh, I'm going to leave you right there. Reform, a divine message, divine direction. Oh, bless his name. Bless his name. Divine direction. Oh, bless his name. Divine direction, and a divine destiny. I hate to shock y'all, and I'm going to close up. I'm going to shock you on this one. When we get to heaven, it's not going to be a black section, a white section. That shocked y'all, didn't it? You went to seminary to get all that? Well, I kind of knew that. God sent me to verify and confirm it. There's not going to be a Chinese section. There's not going to be a... The saints sing a song. Y'all know it. When we all get to heaven, what a day of rejoicing that would be. When we all see Jesus, what we'll do? Sing and shout the victory. That means the poor man will sing, the rich man will sing. The person on the west side, the one on the south side. The one on the north side, District 1, the one on the District 8. Warning. We're going to all worship God together. And so I said this, don't go back the way that we came. Let us come up with words and ways of love. Go another way. Divine message. Oh, bless his name. Divine direction will equal a divine destiny. God bless you. God keep you is my prayer. Amen. Were you blessed by that? I was blessed giving. Amen. I was blessed giving it. At this moment, if you're on the Facebook Live, even if you're on our TV station that will come on later on tonight, amen, and you were challenged by this word, amen, won't you send a message, say, that's me. Type it right in there. That's me. If you got found in this message, it was not my intention because I got found while I was writing it. Amen. Amen. Won't you come to the altar and bring it to God? Don't bring it to the preacher. Because I'm in a dismal condition just like you. Amen. Will you come into the altar and pray if you were challenged? Somebody can't even trust God with their future. Some can't trust God with their grandchildren and their children. They call up, we call them every 30 minutes, every hour. I know my mother-in-law doesn't. She'll be in the same house and still call us. That's because she loves us. We love us. But we want to be able to call on Jesus. He will fix it. Amen. He's the God of our future. This is a moment for you and God. If you'd like to come and pray at the altar, amen. you are more than welcome to do it. I will pray with you. Amen. Divine message, divine direction, and divine destiny. No matter where you are, you can live into your destiny. As a little boy there with a piece of paper balled up, saying 3, 2, 1, and throwing it into the wastebasket. He can see himself in the future. There's a young kid there who has on a doctor's kit that they got for Christmas. They're thinking about their divine destiny. Amen. Amen. Let us pray. Dear God of our past, history's past, God of our present, how desperately put in our hearts to believe you, the God of our future. Lord, not just the future of going to heaven, seeing a new heaven, new earth, but we pray, God, that you would help us to be partners, agents, to bring in that new earth. Partners with Christ to see justice in our family. Some families hate each other over something that happened many years ago. Help us to have justice in our families, in our church. Help us to see justice in our neighborhood. And help us to see justice even in nature, God. That we begin to find ways to support ourselves and preserve nature in such a way that it'll still be here for our children, grandchildren, next generations. Help us to find that right now, God. See ourselves doing it. God, we thank you for those who have listened. And we're praying with them right now at the altar, gathered around the altar. And those who are holding their hands out over the Facebook and YouTube and those in TV land. We're praying, God, that you would give them faith. Increase their faith so that they will be able to see you as the God of the past and God of the future. Same God back then, same God back now, right now. We thank you for this message. Now, God, challenge you, challenge me. Help me to work toward that future in Jesus' name. God, now, there's someone today who want to dedicate their lives, rededicate their lives to Christ. Some want to give their lives to this Christian tradition, to Christ, to Jesus. God, we thank you for them, and we pray for them right now. That you will allow them not to go back the way that they came, but to go another way. We thank you. In Jesus' name, amen. And thank God. God bless you. God keep you is my prayer. I pray that God blessed you through the music, the message, and the meaning of it all. At this moment, praise God. Amen. We will have our benediction. Amen. Oh, we're coming back with another. Okay. Our friends are lifting another offering.
Yes, we have to do. Give a love offering for our pastor and the lovely message he delivered us today.
Amen. They say they're lifting a love offering.
Love offering.
I should have gave them point D too, huh, sister? I gave them A, B, and C. I should have gave them point D. That might have been. God bless you. God keep you. I know it. Save your blood. our prayer. God bless you. Heavenly Father, God, we just bless and thank you for this giving, God. We ask, oh God, that you would cause it to even multiply and bless those that gave, God. Help them to remember the word today, even as they give, that when coming and giving a prophetic worship, oh, bless him, you would give them a divine message. Oh, you've given them a divine message. Oh, bless him. Divine direction and divine destiny. This is our prayer in Jesus' name. Amen. God bless you. Is there any among us today who want to rededicate their lives to Christ today? Is there any of us who have been, like I used to say, shacking up with the church, been coming and coming but won't make that commitment to the church? If that's you, that's this moment right now. If there's any one of you who have never given their lives to Christ, in other words, I believe that Jesus is the Son of God, and that God had raised him dead. You, from the dead. If you haven't confessed that, this is your moment right now. We did altar call, which was a response to the message. But if you feel God tugging at your spirit that St. Luke is the place for me, as unorthodox as this may seem on Facebook Live or on YouTube, amen, say that's me. And I've got people looking at that right now who will respond. Amen. Or if you're here, you want to respond. Amen. I made that response 20 years ago. And boy, did not go through a valley, but God did bring me out. And I tell you, I have a new life in Christ. This could be you. Amen. Amen. Look like the house is secure. Give God a praise right there. Give God a hand of praise. Look like the house is secure. Amen. Amen. Is all hearts and minds clear? Amen. Amen. Let us all stand if you can. Praise him. Praise him. Praise him. Let us praise him. Praise him. Oh, praise him. Jesus, blessed Savior, he's worthy to be praised. Let's do it again. Praise him. Let us praise him. Praise him. I like that. Praise him. Jesus, blessed Savior, he's worthy to be praised. Now unto him who is able to keep us from falling, able to present us faultless before his presence with exceeding joy. To the only wise God, we call him Jesus, be given glory, majesty, dominion, and power, both now and evermore. Let the church say, amen. God bless you. You may sit in reflection as we prepare for dismissing from this mountain.
Whatever my life.
Amen. God bless you. Go in peace.